I stay up for our opening song of worship. For the box of fruit. Scripture reading. Do you know how we can have joy in all circumstances of life, how we can be optimistic and positive in life. It's because we love and serve a risen Savior. He is sovereign and in absolute control of all things. We know that He sees what we don't see. He sees the big picture and what's coming. And we certainly know that He loves us beyond measure. Romans 8:28 says, "We know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose." The Bible doesn't say that all things will work out like we want them to. It simply reminds us that God is in complete control and in fulfilling His purpose in our lives. We walk in the joy of the Lord because we know that His will is best for our lives. And as we go through 2017, that's a good reminder that He sees the big picture and He knows what's coming before we do. So just always rely on Him. Announcements. Merry Christmas. We'll continue to take up a special offering for the paint. Board meeting next Sunday, and we need to start working on the 2017 calendar. Seems like we just worked on 2016. Communion Sunday the 15th, and we need to decide when to take down Christmas decorations. Any other announcements? Okay, on to birthdays. Mr. Scotty Goode here, birthday today, Christmas baby. And Tessa, not here, but if we see her out, wish her a happy birthday. Miss Laura Lee, tomorrow. Did you go in on Christmas Day and deliver the 26th? Okay. Ashley Martin, Wednesday, and Josh, which is Tessa's son, Thursday. So if we see those three out, we'll wish them a happy birthday. So let's. Yeah, a lot of Christmas babies. So we'll sing to Scotty and Lolly.
Don't check. I don't have it here, but don't check. Did any
of them?
Anniversary. Yeah, it's on there.
Yeah, it's on there. Okay. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
And Jack and Annie have an anniversary. Gary, do you know how many years? Tomorrow? 62. Wow. Okay. So. Their anniversary tomorrow, so give them a call. All right, prayer concerns, praises.
Patty's doing well. She came through her surgery Friday, and she's doing pretty good.
Okay, good deal. Any others?
Everybody's letting down Mr. Mills.
Yes. Okay. Anybody we can remove off our prayer list? Mama, can we take Tommy and Goode off? Oh, okay.
But I think she's good.
Well, I think so too. We can remove Miss Tommy and Goode. Who? So are they in need of everything?
Yes,
or?
They have nothing.
Okay.
Except the clothes on their back, just about.
Anybody else we can add?
Homer Scott's son, Homer Street's fiance. Homer, him and his girlfriend were in a grant last night. He had his seatbelt on. He's staying just sore in his bruising and stuff. She didn't have her seatbelt on. She's in the mid right now. She fractured her orbital bone socket, and she's going to have a few surgeries before she's back to normal. And she's also got a chip problem.
Okay.
And what time?
Annabelle Box.
And we remember the family of Tim Ray, my first cousin, passed away yesterday.
Is that RHEA?
And Mr. Larry Rowery at Merle also passed away. Larry Rowery.
Communion will still be up. If you didn't get by yesterday, you can still come today, anytime. Okay. Anybody else we can add to the prayer list? Okay. Brother Eugene? If my voice was at all.
Dear God, for some people it seemed very strange to have church on on Christmas Day, and yet to others of us it doesn't seem, it just seems like the best of all possible time to have church.
That's right.
To remember the miracle that makes all the other miracles of the one we call Jesus possible. And so help the mystery to get in us and through us. Help the mystery to get in us and to get through us. Help us not just to get it, but to give it as well. And we will be very careful to give you the praise for all that you give and all that you enable us to give. Those who are walking through the valley, and those walking through very difficult times, we pray for Christmas peace and Christmas blessings in the most sincere way we know how. Help those who are in hospitals, help Homer's fiance especially, and lift her to new heights by the power of the Holy Spirit. We believe you for it with all the faith we have, and we trust you to bridge the gap between our believing and our doubting. All of us limp between believing and doubting. So thank you that it's not even those who have perfect faith, but those who extend themselves with the faith that they have, who find the power at work within them. Believe for all we've mentioned and all we have, and we do give you the praise for it. It's in Jesus' name we offer this prayer and the silent prayers of each heart using these words. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and power, and glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. Merry Christmas. I can tell Santa Claus has been to see y'all already. I must have been the last one on the route because he hadn't been to my house. I guess I've been bad. Let's turn to page 228. I mean, I'm sorry. 281. See, I'm mourning. Let's stand, please. Bye. Sing all three verses.
Come, be faithful, joyful, and triumphant. Oh, come, be faithful, joyful, and triumphant. Oh, come, be faithful, joyful, and triumphant. God bless each and every gift and each and every giver. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone all around them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for I behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angels a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men. And there we see baby Jesus in the manger, in a simple birth that came a mighty king, that he saved us with his life so that we can go to heaven. Hope you enjoyed your Christmas season and will carry it throughout the next coming year. And when you think of a candy cane, we know that it really is a upside down, looks like a J, doesn't it, for Jesus. So I'm going to give each one of you a candy cane. I want you to think about hearing the love he shares with you every day. You've got a home, you've got people that love you, and you need to share that love with everyone else. Let everyone see Jesus living in you. And I love each and every one of you, and I thank you for all that you mean to our church service by having young people in our church. It's such a blessing.
Searched the end.
See up here, you can follow up here, or you can read in your own, or you can close your eyes and just listen if you want to. In those days, a decree went out from the emperor, Augustus, that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration that was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. Pardon me while I turn my...
And it's on. No, we're good now, Kevin. Let's read that again. Probably wouldn't hurt us to read the scripture two or three times, because if you're like me, you zone out real quickly. In those days, a decree went out from the emperor, whose name was Augustus, that all the world should be registered.
And this was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went to the town of Nazareth in Galilee, to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and the family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Santa Claus was good to me this year. Santa Claus was better to me this year than I deserve, more than likely. The carnage was grand and glorious after all the presents had been unwrapped. The carnage, all the paper, all the bags, all the boxes, all the stuff. But I was told that my Christmas at the buyer's house this year was very tame compared to what it used to be in times past. That what we had this year for Christmas was just a smattering of what we used to have, but as far as I was concerned, it was like the loaves and the fishes, because the gifts just seemed to multiply and come from nowhere. And so we each had our own gifts and we worked through them slowly. There was an order to it that I didn't know until I got there, and I was sort of given the order of opening of the gifts. And there was one big bag that just about every one of us had. And I was said, do not open this until the very end. I said, okay, I won't open it until the very end. And I tried to remind myself every once in a while, I wanted to go and open the bag. And I said, no, I don't need to open the bag until the very end. And I opened the bag at the end, and it apparently was called the goodie bag. And as far as I was concerned, if I had gotten just a little portion of what was in the goodie bag, I would have gotten more Christmas than I would have expected. But any number of things came, it came last, but was still some of the most eye-popping, some of the gifts that made me go, ooh, boy, I'm glad I waited until last to open that. And then got home, and we had been opening Christmas for weeks and weeks. It's sort of the way we roll in our house. We don't do Christmas one day. We do Christmas any number of days, any number of weeks, and it may get to the point where we do Christmas all year long. Nothing wrong with that. And so I had forgotten that I had a stocking that I needed to open, and was reminded by one of the little elves this morning that I needed to open my stocking. And the last thing again that I opened proved to be some of the most surprising of all. And I tell you all that to tell you that it's very easy to get into the sort of Christmas season and feel like you know the way everything goes. You know all the rules and you know all the words. But I want to give you a couple Christmas gifts. I had a person tell me long ago that a sermon ought to be a gift that's unwrapped for everyone. So this is a sort of Christmas gift, or Christmas gifts, which is the name of the message. Christmas gifts unwrapped for everyone. And it will be very, very short. At least it seems to me very short. Maybe it won't seem very short to you, but it will not go very long. But Christmas gifts that we unwrap, when we unwrap these words and look and see what these words have to tell us, and the first is the gift of family. Now, I know what you think. You think that Jesus was born in a Motel 6 or a Holiday Inn, some sort of motor inn. And it's entirely possible that that word inn means that, but more than likely, here's what it means. Because Joseph had to go to his hometown of Bethlehem. And at that time, there were about 300 to 1,000 people that lived in Bethlehem. There are probably 20 to 30,000 people that live in Bethlehem in this day and age. But probably about 300 to 1,000 people that lived there. And so when Joseph went to Bethlehem to be in his hometown, he went to be with him. He went to be with his family. And there are people that believe that when they went to an inn, what that meant is that they went to a place where family was living. And the inn was the guest house that was the other side. You ever been to a house that has sort of a guest room? That was the guest portion of the house. And so when it says that there was no room in the inn, no room in the guest house, what it means is that there was so much family that was piled up. And some of us know about this. Some of us don't. Some of us had a very quiet, very small, very peaceful Christmas. But some of us had family on family on family piled up in the house. And that's the picture there of the inn, of the guest house. There was family piled up in there. And they had to do something for the baby that was being born. And so they found a manger, which was what? A feeding trough. So to be born in the inn, to be born in a manger because there wasn't any room in the inn, doesn't mean that some nasty innkeeper kicked them out. That's the way it's come down. But it means that there were so many family members that they had to do something in the spur of the moment, which is the way we do life. Sometimes we just do what we can do, and that's all we can do. And if you don't know what I mean, just hang on, because it'll come. There are times when all you can do is what you can do, and that's all you can do. And so it's the gift of family, of staying with family, and it's a beautiful Christmas gift because it means that Joseph's family was taking care of people that needed to be taken care of. So even in the birth of Jesus, Jesus was in a place where there was Christmas giving going on. You know what the Bible says? God takes the solitary and places them in families. And you may not know about that, but some of us do. I will tell you that family is not necessarily your flesh and blood. Family are the people who care about you. You got what I just said? I'm going to say that again just in case everybody can hear me. You go through life, and I go through life thinking that your family is people, is those people, are those people. Your family are those people who share the same DNA that your blood comes from. And that ain't the way it is. Your family, and the ultimate, is the people who take care of you, the people who look after you. There are people that come to church and they say, and I know we're small today, I know we're small in numbers, quit looking. Some of y'all looking around wondering where everybody is. Don't worry about that. The people that are here are the people that are here. And someone can catch this on the podcast. The people listen to the podcast, they can get it later. But there are people that come into a congregation, that come into a church, or come into a family and find for the very first time in their life something they never had in their entire life. And if you can't identify with it, just try to imagine for a minute what it would feel like to be alone in this life and all of a sudden find a place of belonging. Family. Jesus had a family. Jesus had a family that gave birth to him. Jesus had a family that raised him. Jesus had a family that taught him. Jesus had a family that brought him up. So being born here in this manger, in this isolated place, in this small town, is the gift of family. And sometimes you have to let go of the family that you've known to find the family that you need to find.
That's right.
That really is right. That is right. That's not just because I'm a preacher up here talking for a few minutes. That is right. To be able to let go of what can no longer come in order to embrace what is right in front of you is a great gift. And is the gift of family. God places the solitary in families. Whatever the house looks like, whatever the people around you look like, the people that take care of you, the people that look after you, are your family. And so it's a gift of belonging, and no small thing, because all of us have to figure out that we, at some point, we have to figure this out in this life. You feel alone. You feel all alone in this world. All of us go through this, and we say, I wonder if there's anyone who cares. And to find out that not only is there a God who cares, but there is a God who cares enough to give us people that care about us. No small thing. And so Jesus, born in a manger, in a feeding trough, what they used to feed the animals, this is the plain truth, okay? You can say that a manger is wrought with gold and is some angel-encrusted device. All it is just a little thing that not the angels ate out of, but the animals ate out of. And covered in leftover pieces of cloth. You got it? You got it? Basic stuff. Plain, ordinary stuff. Humble stuff. Simple things that held and that covered the very Son of God. The simple things. You know what simple things do more than anything else? They give you comfort when you don't know where the comfort is going to come from. The Bible actually says that God is close to those who are broken and those who are crushed in spirit. And one of the ways God brings comfort to those who are broken, and you say, I'm not broken. Well, okay, well, you can just sit here and listen and you can look very sweet. But one of the ways that God ministers to people who are broken and who are crushed is to give them very, very simple things. You know, you can throw a whole bunch of money at it and it still doesn't feel like Christmas. And here comes something very inexpensive, very unspecial seeming. And yet it carries with it all the love that you can imagine. We were listening to it on the radio this morning. You ever listen to Sunrise, S-O-N Rise, with John Tesh, who's a great musician, by the way. And he was telling about a couple that fell in love on the internet, but neither one of them had much money. But he wanted to give her a ring, and so he gave her like $130 ring, something like that, which, you know, to the way the world thinks, that's cheap. And the jeweler said that. I can't believe the cheapskate that gave a $130 ring to his bride. And the reason he did it is because they couldn't afford anything more. And that lady looked at that jeweler, and she said, you know, it's not the expense of the gift, but it's the love that fills the gift. It is the simple things in life, and maybe we'll need to sing that song, Simple Things, sometime. It's a glorious and beautiful song. It's the simple things in life to make the world go round as much as anything else. You don't need more than one change of clothes, believe me. Some of y'all got, some of us got more clothes. Man, I met a girl one time, I had 100, get a load of this, had 100 pair of shoes. Lived up in Vermont. These are sweet people, nice people. Had 100 pair of shoes, and I asked her, how come you got 100 pair of shoes? She said, because I don't have 101 yet. Had a closet full of shoes bigger than the apartment I was living in. You don't need that many clothes. I'm not putting her down. If she ever happens to listen to this, God bless you. I ain't talking to you. I ain't hating you. I'm loving you. All you need, you don't. You actually don't even need a house that you've known. There are very few things that you need to make it in this life, and it's the simple things in life. It took me a long time to figure out, a long, long, painful time to figure out that the things that come with ribbons and bows are not the real gifts. Maybe Christmas doesn't come from a store, he said. Maybe Christmas means just a little bit more. The simple things of a manger, of clothing that doesn't even look like clothing. And it's the simple things in your life and the simple things in my life that make the world what it really is, make my inner world, my inner universe, my inner reality very real. And some of y'all learn it somewhere down the line. It's not because I have a big fancy car, and it's not because I have $1 million in the bank that I'm happy. Because that'll make you happy. You can have all the money in the world, and it still won't buy happiness. It may make it easier. It may make life easier, and it does. It's better to have a few bucks in the bank at the end of the month to pay your bills. Trust me, but it ain't going to buy you happiness. And so it was a simple thing in the life of the baby Jesus, and it's the simple things in our life too. I know you want to go to the house. We're almost done. Simple things. What did I say? Simple things. The gift of family. And finally, it's the gift of presence. Bless you. The gift of presence. Not presence. P-R-E-S-E-N-T-S. Not presence like that, but P-R-E-N-S-E-N-C-E. Did I spell it right? Presence. I get lost sometimes. Presence. The presence without which none of the other gifts mean a cotton-picking thing. Presence. I know. I know it. I know it's not a real baby. I know it's not. I know it's not. But the presence that comes what? In the gift of a child. The presence of peace and joy that you feel right here. And it's a gift. It's a gift. This presence, this peace that passes understanding. You can't buy it. You can't get it at Belk in Tupelo. You can't tank up with it at the Shell station with your Shell card that you just got for Christmas. You say, now I got, now. No, you don't. Presence is a gift. You say, why are you telling us all this? I'm telling you this for a very simple reason. The humble surroundings, the very simple things that surround the life of Jesus tell us something very important, and it's this. There is the Son of God in a feeding trough and leftover clothing. How can you and I possibly think that we can make it in our life without humility? Bam. Bam. God lives close to those who are crushed in spirit. God lives close to those who don't know where they belong. But more than anything else, the presence of the very living God lives in those of humble heart. Life has a way of breaking you. And if you and I refuse to humble ourselves, life will humble you. It really will. But the gift of humility. The Christmas song says it this way. When meek hearts still receive him, the dear Christ enters in. The gift of humility. If you're looking down all the time, get this, I'm coming down now. If you're looking down on everybody because of your brains, because of your strength, because of your wealth, whatever it is, if you're looking down all the time, you can never look what? You can never look up. The gift of humility, and it is a gift. Like so many other things, it's a gift that comes with great mystery, but I will tell you what humility is like. It's like butterfly wings. And one of you scientists out there may correct me, but I'm told that butterfly wings never work quite the same when you start to mess with them. So it is with humility. It works through you. You say you want Bible for it? I'll give you Bible for it. New Testament, Old Testament. God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble.
I am the Lord who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy, who lives in a high and holy place, and yet lives with those who are of humble and contrite heart. If you want to know where God lives, that's a silly question, isn't it? If you want to know where God lives, he lives in those of humble heart. The first church I ever really worked at had a sign on the door, and I wish I could have brought it, but it was the church's, so I couldn't steal it. And it went like this: the way up is down. The way up is down. If you want a gift, if you want a gift this Christmas, if you're sitting there and you want a gift this Christmas, try the gift of humility. Because the one who was born into humble circumstances, the one who came from a place we can scarcely imagine to a place that all of us can identify with, is the one who still comes in the plain and the ordinary. The way up is always down. Happy Christmas. Happy Christmas, as our British friends say. Happy Christmas from Jesus to all of us. Let us pray. Jesus, be born in us and among us, who are able to say, I need help. I need a Savior. Won't you be my Savior? We bless you, God, in the name of the Savior, even Jesus. Amen. Ms. Tommy.
286. Ms. Dan.
Amen. Amen. We won't be ruined. It might seem there's an ocean in between.